So hello everyone, and welcome to episode 30 of Enterprise Tech India Unplugged. And today we have a very interesting guest, and I will let Kumaran introduce her. Go ahead, Kumaran.
Yeah, so we've known her for many years now, decades probably, and she's one of the very few people who I have known has worked through the ranks and started at a very low level, basically entry level in IT, and now she plays a purely functional business role in a classical non-IT organization. So I thought it was good that all of us can hear to her experiences of these multi-exposed experience, so we could probably learn from that. So yeah, that's the background to her.
So Suvi, why don't you tell us what was the most interesting part of your journey from starting as, I believe you said, as a tester in a very large organization working for a US customer? How has the journey been? What was the most interesting part?
I think we would even start at the beginning of the journey, right? Like people usually for education and improvement, they move from villages and towns to big cities, okay? So she managed to go from a metro to a
small
unnamed village in Tamil Nadu. Okay.
Okay.
All the way there. So maybe you can start off with that.
Yeah. The metro that you're saying, Kumaran, was Mumbai, right? I was born and brought up in Mumbai. And then the village that you're saying I went to for my post-graduation is Tiruchirappalli Valley. So yeah, you're right. You know, it was a major reason I went there. At that point in time when I was in Mumbai, there was no classroom education for masters, the one that I wanted to pursue. So I wanted to pursue computer applications, and the only university that was there was an open university. So my parents were not too keen that I go there, and we started looking out. And I am from Kerala. And the place, Tirunelveli, is actually borders with Kerala. So I went to the university. We had to give a sort of an entrance exam at that point, which was new to me. And then I got in. And that's how I went. The highlight of the thing is, you know, it was like a real village. A village where, you know, internet connection was also very scarce, right? So we used to queue up outside internet shops to have our weekly communication with my friends back in family and friends back in Mumbai. So, you know, it was that bad.
15 rupees per hour for browsing.
I think it was 6 rupees per hour.
Okay. Okay.
And the internet used to break every 5 minutes, right? I mean, it's just really bad. And but it was a very good experience, because going from a city to see how things work around there, everything was new for me. I mean, the food, the culture, everything was new. Hmm. But it was a very good experience. And but the university had campus selections, and that's how this big IT company came in and recruited me. So that was one plus that happened there. So that's how my journey started.
And, interesting.
So this organization that I went into, I started at entry level, right, where I was given a role as a tester. So I used to sit and test all the codes that these big guys used to write. I used to sit in a corner and test these codes. And our client was a very big client in the US. So with the hope that one day I land in US, right? That's a big hope. Hope that you have.
On site.
On site, yes, everybody. And then you see, and then you always compare yourself with your batchmates who are with you. You know, some guys get lucky, right? They are like really lucky. They can just within a year I see some of my batchmates go. And then that was the first time when US introduces lottery system of visas. So what happened was I was the unlucky one. My application never got picked. So you know, I was there for the longest time until I got my first break to this US client that I went to. But that was again, so I progressed from the testing to developing codes and developing small interfaces. And, you know, that's how, so that was my first role on site.
It's kind of interesting. You were just saying moving from a city to a world. So yesterday evening, I was in a call with a very large BPO organization. Okay. And this was a night call and we were working with a batch from US. Okay. Brace yourself, Deepak. So they are trying to install UiPath. Okay. And they are having problems and we are kind of helping them how to identify an opportunity for the business to adopt. So it's a citizen developer program. And the person says, you know, finally IT has agreed to do an upgrade of our Windows machines. I said, excellent. We will go to Windows 8. I was like, oh. So they're on Windows 7. So, Suvi, it's not necessarily old and small villages are backward in technology. Okay. So it's kind of, I mean, I never quite expected it, right? In US, somebody being there. So, I think these are, what do you call,
paradoxes.
Quirks of the IT landscape that we live in, or the jungle that we live in. Anyway, continue. Yeah.
So I was like a pure technology, right? So I, a technology person, I used to develop interfaces, use IBM as one of our, okay, am I supposed to use names?
Yeah, that's fine.
As one of our products, and we had a lot of enterprise architecture tools that was used, and we used to use that. So I was a pure techie when I started my career with this organization. So I've been with that organization for 8 years, and then I had multiple on-site opportunities. Not exactly. I did go to US, and I also went to China. So that was my, the most important, the turning point for me. Was me going to China. So I was part of this client. And none of the, at that point, right, there were no ladies who were ready to go to China. So I think I plunged on that opportunity. And for me, it was okay. You know, I wanted to see. So this is an opportunity to see another place where no one has been to, because the boom is all about US, right? Nobody wants to go to Asia.
Yeah, everybody goes country. There. Big deal. So, that's for mere mortals. I'm Suvi. I go to China.
Yes, I went to China, and it was not because I.
What year was that? Going to China.
Going to China was 2007. 2008 was me going to China.
That curiosity is because Deepak has been his second home from for the past 2 years. He has another family in China.
I spent a lot of time in China. Yeah.
For the record, working family.
Working family.
Microsoft family, other family. Okay.
Yes.
And I think that's a long-term engagement. I think it's like some 2 years.
Yeah. I'm still doing it remotely now.
But China was really not what I expected it to be, right? I mean, I went to Shanghai and I was amazed by the people there. You just heard of up until then about Chinese, and even the worst thing, that the experience that I had is the food, right? I'm expecting the Chinese, Indian Chinese food that I've grown up. And I go there and I go there and I have this.
What? You don't have chicken chili Manchurian? What kind of Chinese are you?
I don't know what a Manchurian is, you know. I don't know what a Szechuan soup is. So all of these, for me, that was a paradigm shift. I was like, the biggest disappointment that I had was, it's not the Indian Chinese food that I grew up with. And I look at them and it's bland, right? There's no spice whatsoever in their food. But that was another experience. And then I sort of liked China. So I stayed there for 3 years. And then I came back to India within. So this was a manufacturing company. A function that I was working with. The first one that I did was a retail option. And then from here, I go back to India with another on-site opportunity again. But this time it was UK, London. That was another dream that I wanted to be in that place. And I went back to India, waited for all the formalities to be done. And then, you know, we never landed the client. So I had my visas ready, but you know, the organization didn't land the client. So then I was asked again, do you want to go back to China? Or should I or do I want to go back to, I think 10 years into this organization. And I thought, you know, it's high time I look for a change. And that's how I landed a very different role in a stream where I had not worked before. So this is the banking and finance sector, and an opportunity opened up in Singapore. So, and the money was good. So Singapore was the place that I heard of when I went to China, because before that I've heard of Singapore, but I used to think it's a very small place where nothing happens there, right? I mean, that was the view I had. And then I was amazed to find that, you know, it's a whole banking and finance industry that is there. And that was
one. It's a New York of the East Asia.
It is, right? But, you know, this, our thoughts are so clouded with US and the clients in US. We hardly notice these small countries here. Or I was not aware, because for me, it was all US and then I like China. But when I went to China, I met some Singaporeans in this in the client place that I went to. And they're the ones who told me about how good Singapore is as a place where if you want to explore your career and in the finance industry. So that's something that I thought I should try. And that's how I landed in Singapore with this big international.
So what was the main difference between what you used to do earlier and what you did in the banking and finance industry? What was the main difference in the work which you did?
Work. Okay. So from a work perspective, nothing had changed yet. So It was still technology. I was still recruited. If you know this product called Web Methods, that is an interface tool that is used. So I was recruited purely for a technical role as a technical analyst. The work was, I was no longer doing coding. So I was more into, I left the coding behind. I was more into technical architecture, building these functional documents. Okay, so first was the technical documentation part. So you know there is a requirement and you're managing a technical bit. So you have a document that you need to make in a technical format, which should then be passed on to your offshore centers, which is in India, where they will develop the code. So that was the work that I had come to do.
So you're working in the border areas.
Yes, in the border areas, right? Very safe, very safe. But you still do not know what business is. You still do not know what is the code that they're using there or how are they going to do it. So they're still in a very functional. So my role was also called a very, you know, I had a very fancy name. I was called a functional business analyst. It was a very... I'm like, you know, either it is a business analyst or you're a technical analyst. I do not understand this functional business analyst. What do you mean by functional business analyst? So, you know, the same thing. So the person at that point who recruited me, my boss, he said, this is like, you know, borderline. You're not neither here nor there, right? So that's when it struck that, you know, there is a possibility that I can gradually move towards the area that I want to go. That is, you know, towards understanding more of business. The path I wanted to take, but at that point when I landed in Singapore, the whole thing, right, to Deepak, to your question, the whole thing was new. The whole banking industry was new. I was not aware. I knew that, you know, I used to go and make some transaction, the bank would withdraw some money and do some overdraft or, you know, send some money somewhere else, but that's it, right? That was my knowledge, though my dad was a banker, but this is the only thing that I knew. And I knew there were branches. When I come to Singapore, the whole thing was new. I mean, the banks are like these 50-story buildings, right? I'm like, oh, what do they do here, right? In India.
Yeah, I mean, we are used to that old Katara chain grated thing with the dusty files kind of thing.
And
right?
Then you have a security also standing at the door in India, right? Mm-hmm. Like, this is nothing like it, right? The whole view was different. And then I realized that, you know, there are back offices, as they call. I knew there is offshore development center where, you know, our poor coders and our poor startups sit and, you know, develop codes. I have no idea there's something like a back office that existed for banks, and the amount of work that happens in the bank, it's something that I'm not aware of. So the first 3 years went in this role where, you know, I was still a functional analyst where I used to understand the business requirements. So my input was always a business requirement document that used to come from the business, which I used to dissect and make a functional and a technical spec, which is then forwarded to the developers to develop the requirement. So that was my role. So a good
tell us some interesting story of such documents, because these documents are notorious for their
what they did to people's happiness.
It's left to interpretation, Deepa, if you ask me, right? So you'll have a requirement. The interesting thing about this is it is easily misunderstood. So the most interesting thing that I felt while I was dealing with these was my walkthrough session. So once you write a document based on whatever you've understood, you have a walkthrough, you face off with the client, right? And you actually tell them what is it that I've written and you know, how have I read your business requirement document and what is it that I'm going to do so that you get the output. You get what you want. It's like, you know, those funny, I think Kumaran, you would know, right? How a requirement comes in, how it transforms, and then it becomes, you know, it, someone wants
completely
to,
different from
the
what?
Tree, the tree,
So it used to be the transition for me also was that. So most of the times, it is very easy for me to talk about the requirements to the developers. Okay, so it was because I come from a technical background, it was easy for me to transition there. The document that I wrote and for me to convey it back to the business for them to then sign off officially to say this is what, yes, this you have met my requirements was very difficult. They do not understand technicalities. So your documents are plain English, which is an extension. If you ask me, it's like an extension of your business requirement, but with little bit of those technical words. And a technical sort of the whole expectation of what is required would be another additional document that we used to attach. So for me, the biggest challenge was explaining, you know, what I'm trying to do, your requirement back to them, right? Their requirement back to them was the biggest challenge. They will not understand. And they would go line by line to say, does this mean that, you know, for example, I can still remember I was working on a static data management tool, like they have, they call it, right? Basically, there is a sort of a workbench where the client static data can be updated. Okay, those are static data which, and they never had a sort of a workbench or an interface to do it. They directly used to enter it in the old core banking systems, as they call it, right?
There so is would it be like some... master data when you say static?
Yeah,
it's like master
yeah.
data.
Yeah, it is a master. So there is a system.
So I think this is a difference, right? Like, for example, when you're telling that as a techie guy, I'm thinking master data. But for them, it is static data,
static
right? It's
data.
Just that same language mismatch. My mind immediately says master table, transaction table, relation
yeah,
table.
Yeah, but from a technical aspect, I can understand when they're saying. But, you know, for them to, if I go and tell master static table to the technology team, they don't understand. For them, right. The language that I then have to use is this only. Your master table, master data, stuff that. So building the workbench for them, right? They wanted, these guys didn't have.
On a side note, one small deterrent. Interesting thing is happening in the world out there. Because of all this, whatever rights and other things, right? You cannot call master slave anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's incorrect.
politically correct language. Politically
yeah,
correct language.
I'm serious. You're not supposed to use master slave. People are transcending that. Similarly, blacklisting, whitelisting is not there. Allowed and not allowed.
Oh,
because black and white is color.
No, we still use.
Yeah,
it.
I guess you have to get more. You have to become more inclusive. You can say allowed and not allowed. You cannot say black means bad. You cannot say blacklist.
So
you're saying something about the requirements. Yeah,
yeah,
statics.
Yeah,
static
so
data.
So the requirements that come in and the way the translation has happened from
and this is what we do. We distract the people who are talking with some other side stories, and then we'll have to get them back. They'll be like, I'm lost. I was talking something. Where have you taken me? It's okay. Come.
I forgot.
I know where
I forgot.
You are. But we.
I don't know if I've answered Deepak's question, right?
No,
that's
correct.
That's good. It's good.
This is interesting.
It's nice.
No, you see, this is a conversation. You don't have to answer the question. What we are interested in is the conversation, right? So,
yeah.
so you were saying actually that these requirements when they mainly the business people have to be so convinced that what you're doing.
Finish that story. Art. That story about that static data you were telling, yeah. Right?
Yeah, the static data was it was a very simple thing, but the way the requirement had come in and the way dialogue had happened between us, I'm like in between the technology and the business. I'm this middleman who's mm-hmm. stuck in between, right? And I have to convince or I have to convey the right message so that we have the right output, because the business guys cannot talk the language the technology wants to hear. So we sort of, I was an interpreter in between. Mm. And this thing that I did, the static data page set in a workbench where the business users would have access and they can edit it, because the core banking system, as they call it, is not like a very user-friendly system. And it is, I think it was that particular system that I'm talking about is around 15, 20 years old. Okay, so there's no much technology or no upgrades done to it. So users wanted something fancy, and then automatically it has to go and update that core banking system. So this was the whole project. So you have different layers. Now it's not easy, right? When I say this, it's very easy. You start, you do something here, and you connect it. That connection to the backend system is not a very easy thing. So there were nuances which was not very easy. Even in this end where we have to capture that data, being a bank and being a financial institution, we have to follow policies and procedures. And we, being a foreign bank, we had to follow the procedures prescribed by the bank. So that aspect is something that I had never learned of in my previous experience. That's something that was new to me. So if they would tell me as if I know it, right? But then, I have to go back.
It's an implicit requirement. Like they will tell the requirement, but the compliance part, you have to account for yourself.
I have to account. I mean, I have to then read those documents to understand.
That's a very good point, Sri. This is as technologists, right? We typically miss that. We just take that functional requirement and then interpret it. But I think business has a lot of other factors which normally gets me. I think that what you're telling is a great example of that. Continue. Yeah.
Yeah. And the business that I'm seeing are multiple guys, right? They are representatives of management, middle management, and representative of operations. So the guys and the guys who are using these core banking systems are also they are the operations team. They are a very big stakeholder, because they know the intricacies of how each field is represented in the end. And without that, right? So the problem that I saw was initially we did not have this operations team in any of these discussions. So my first round was very cozy with my business, and what they wanted and all was translated into, after me learning the procedures and stuff, and translated and done. So we had the first cut out. And during our testing, we found out that, they were missing links. And then we realized that the requirement was incomplete. And that's
keeping with the analogy of being in the border, you stepped on a landmine.
I did, right? And I suddenly became the problem, and I was a person who had not thought of it.
Of course you were. Of course you were. What thought of? That's what it is.
yeah, my God. I'm like, I was the problem in between. And that was a learning for me, because, and that was also a learning for the business, because they had not provided the right amount of experience into putting up a business requirement document, because they just from a very senior stakeholder or from a senior management level came up with a very, very hosh-posh sort of a requirement. But, they did not go into the intricacies of what would have happened.
Okay.
Then that's when the second phase, when we had the operations team in, and a lot changed over that, right?
So within that you had the actual user or a business stakeholder, and then there is the operation. And when you say operations, was it IT operations or business operations?
Business operations. So these are business operations guys who are the back office that I told you about, right? They are the guys who actually do the work, enter all the data in the required systems. Okay, so those guys were never consulted or never. So when I went and we started this, this project was supposed to be done in a 16-month period. So the whole project was a 16. It became a good 2.5-year project post that. Right? So,
if not that, how will services company make money? Come on, if you just finish it on time as per requirement, people will die of hunger, man. Oh, all developers will be on the streets. What are you talking?
So this reminds me of the last episode we had on project management.
Yeah. So one from a one single project that my boss had recruited me for. And I was also contracting staff. I was not on the payrolls of a company. I was taken as a contractor. And my contract was for 2 years. And I was supposed to, this was a 16-month
contract. So you managed to extend the contract smartly. Huh?
It became like that, right? It became phase one, phase two, phase three.
I mean, I'm joking, but...
That's
how it looks like, right? The IT is just dragging something which can be done easily and short. But just to...
In this case, no, right, Kumaran? This was not IT dragging it at all. This was pure mishandling of the requirements by the first liners, the guys who actually give the requirements from the senior stakeholders.
So that part I'm trying to understand that a little bit. I think this is taken for granted. So you see, there's somebody giving the requirement, right? And someone using it, even within operations. So what is the profile of the person from whom you collected the first requirements and the ones who came later, probably towards integration testing or acceptance testing, they were coming. What was the difference between what the first stakeholders said and the actual ones who were about to use it? What were the gaps there?
So the gaps were, if you ask me, were the lack of the different usages of operations. So basically, the operation guys have different layers of how the data is entered, right? So it was not a straight through. The assumption the business guys had was I enter it here and it reaches here. But there's a lot of other activity the operation guy does before the data reaches the end state. So that was not considered. Now, if you do not do that, our BAU would be affected. So a normal, the expectation is that when we go live, BAU should continue as is because it's just adding a new front end for these JASI users, right? But that would have broken at that point. So operations guys bought that knowledge in, which these guys were unaware of because these were like, you know, the frontliners, like relationship managers who bring in a client and they do not have that. So the requirement was fully driven by their requirement. I mean, this is how I want my screen to look. This is how it should be without understanding, you know, what else would be required. So they were still operations who never gave any requirements. They were supposed to give in the requirements and that would then smoothly allow us to send the data the way we want. So there was a whole operation miss.
So I think it's kind of, if I kind of have to take a learning for all listening, I think it's, one is we get the requirement, right? What wants to be done. But then the other part is about how do we operationalize it? Who will use it? What stages? I think that kind of misses. So it's something like, for example, we would say, what do you want? Okay. Or if I have to take a simple house analogy, what do you want? Okay. So I want to have biryani for lunch. Okay. So, okay, let's make biryani. It's not that, right? Like you have to wash the vessel. You need a vessel for the biryani. You need... a steaming pot. You need things like that. I think that's where the real gaps are. Yeah. Okay. Go on. I think.
So this became a close to 32 months project post that, right? But the learning for me was I learned banking procedures. I learned something about customer due diligence. I learned. A lot of thing that has helped me come to be in this role today that I'm in, right? So I've seen that system. So that system is still widely used in the organization that I work for. and was upgraded, updated to the latest, you know, technology. But the base, you know, it's still there. So people are still using it. I'm very proud that, you know, it's still there. And nice. It works well.
So banks are notorious for not letting go of the legacy. They'll have the mainframes from 60s are still running. So they will never get rid of it. They'll have
just
layers
the,
and
the
layers
outer look and feel, right? Yeah. Layers and layers. And that's what I'm saying, right? These layers were the reason why we had a problem in the first place. There were plenty of layers which we were not aware of.
I think so.
It's like this onion, peeling the onion, right?
So if you go to those, if you see those action movies, right? So people will kind of show, you know, see my scratch here. Then this girl say, no, see my cut here. Then it says, see my bullet wound here, like that, right? So I guess this one gave you a lot of scars and wounds. And that kind of helped you to go to the next rule, right? I think we could kind of segue into that. So then how did that chance arise? And how did you say, you know what, I'm going to diverge IT and get married to business?
Yeah, so the thing, right, is always our interactions that we have with the business. So when I came in, I just came in new to the country, to the place, just seeping in as much exposure that I can have and understanding how it works, right? One thing I realized here is nothing works here without proper contacts, and everything is an inside. So even if there is a job requirement which is posted outside, they would have already headhunted and kept a person ready for the role. Okay. And that's how it works. That's how it works in this market. So with my knowledge and with the experiences and the number of people that I've met, I realized that side, like, you know, that point in time, I used to call it that side, right? The business side, the side from where everything, the orders come in, right? And where the money comes from. What is it that they are doing differently? Because I used to interact with them in a day to day. But there are a lot of things that we think that, you know, these guys just don't know anything, right? They just come up with something without giving us details. But there are people who actually have been in these roles, like we say, the business, for years. And for them, like we just said, right, the static data and they do not understand the technology or whatever, but they're very good at that part, right? That bit of handling the clients and bringing in business and talking, you know, stuff. So there are processes. Like, if I have to tell you, I was looking after something called as client due diligence a big wholesale segment, if I can call it that way. And client due diligence is a process. It's like, you know, it's not as easy as you just walk in to the bank to open an account. There's a lot of process involved. And all of these processes is bound, like I said, by policies and procedures. Okay.
That will be both internal and government.
Regulatory. Yeah.
Regulatory.
Company. Internal, regulatory, and also wherever your bank, wherever your institute is originating from, the local regulations there, the global regulations. So it is, you know, you have to keep. And the thing is, right, that is when you realize, has to be considered from two levels. One is the global requirement, then, you know, the countries that you're implementing this for. So there's a lot of documentation and it is very difficult.
I think that's everything. A very important point again. I would probably, I think we make those points now, Deepak. Maybe this is another key one, is that understanding the regulatory. So 2 days back, I had one of my mentees calling me and he said, you know, they are a startup. They said, you know, we want to add our link to the SBI's page. Okay. And he said, like, I have to kind of tell that it is Shopify or it is GDPR compliant. Okay. But I'm only using Shopify as a service. So I don't have to do anything, right? I said, no, it's not like that. So if you just say, you know what, it's like that, they'll just reject your application. okay, you have to go to Shopify, get a certificate. See, he says, you know, I'm not doing anything, so I don't have to tell anything. Okay, but it is only your company's link that's coming on the SBI page. So, so I had to tell him, you have to go to Shopify, contact their customer support, contact their legal, and get a certificate from them telling my company is a customer of Shopify and Shopify is GDPR. You have to get an official document. Don't come with one email. So it's kind of, this thing is what the tech misses, right? You know what? I'm not writing code. No, so I'm not responsible.
And the another thing is, right, the implications is huge. If I miss out on a requirement or to capture a particular requirement, that would hit me later. And when I say hit, it's like, you know, as easy as getting fined for not following process, right? So we are legally bound by all of these things, and we have to follow the policies. And if we miss, right? If we miss, and that is the responsibility that lies with these guys, the front end users who give these requirements. And that's exactly what my role is currently, right? To ensure that whatever is the requirement or from a compliance perspective is taken care of when I go live, right? Because then I own, right now the space that I'm in, I own a particular financial crime compliance stuff for particular segments. And I, if there's something that goes into the system which is non-compliant, the institute gets fined, I might lose my job. So it's a very, and this is something that, you know, you being on the technology side would never understand, because you just are developing a code that has been given to you in a paper, and that's it, without knowing why are we doing it and what is the implication if we don't do it. That is what the business carries. And that's the risk the business carries. And the translation of that requirement into the right thing so that, you know, you get what you want without missing on those points is where people like me sit to ensure that, you know, am I meeting all of it? My risk is all of my, whether I'm all of my risks are covered. So those things is what I've grown up to understand when I got into these roles. And it is not easy.
So how do you pick up that knowledge? Like you come from this background, right? Like typically people who are in business usually have said, let's say a BCom or a banking exam, have studied and they have grown through that. But let's say after, as in Tamil, you're 2-3 donkeys old, right? By the time you switched from here to there. Okay.
Yeah.
So I think all of us are, right? By the time you reach that stage, how do you go and learn something like that? I mean, what are the ways that's possible? How do you make yourself aware that things like this exist?
For me, it was all on the job, right? So when I started with the technology thing for like this developing of these things also, there were enough documents available that had to be read and understood. And these are like real documents, which are like, you know, 150 pages big or even bigger than that.
The
right?
frown on your face shows how big the documents were. The wrinkles on your forehead.
I mean, really?
that feeling is coming. You can imagine the document.
Right?
I
know, right? So it is not easy. Kumaran, if you ask me, right, it is definitely not easy. And then there are certifications available that can then give you a certification that you are eligible to do this particular job. So I handle a particular compliance section. And we have certifications from the leading industry support.
External certifications.
Teams who actually comply with external certifications, internal certifications as well. Within the organization, for us to be benchmarked for a particular role, you have internal certifications. And then for you to have a global recognition, you have external certification. So I started on the job. The job that I landed into the business side was purely because of my experience from the technology and the faith that, you know, I can do the job in the business side, because now I've understood the whole technology to understand where the business are coming from. It is just on the job learning, right? And like the frown on my face, you have to read these documents and understand. And then you always have legal advisors and compliance advisors whom you can go to if you have queries. So you have enough support for you to, and that's how my shift happened. And for me, I did not feel much of a pain because I've had in my daily interactions into bringing that product live, I have had all of the experience that I need to give the right requirements, right? For me to start from it, it was just a matter of reading those documents and making that I am giving, from a regulatory perspective, I've covered my ass, if I can say that, so, and then move it forward. So it was for me purely on the job. And then for after you landed that the business role, so I was in a pure process place where, you know, in the retail segment, where it was like a SME, the small and medium enterprises. So those were the clients, that was the segment that I was handling, where, you know, you have like, you know, individual customers like us, right? Who are actually called individual bankers, and then you have SME. So that was one under, it fell under retail. So I handled that particular section, that particular work. And I also looked at processes. So basically, it was more into, like I said, my base was always client due diligence, always anti-money laundering, always into financial crime and compliance. So it was me building processes to ensure that we do not fail anywhere. So that was my role. And that also involved system development. So for us to ensure we do not fail anywhere, I had to give system requirements, or I had to keep enhancing my existing systems so that, you know, I meet those requirements. So these processes, like I said, they keep changing and they keep upgrading every year sometimes every 6 months. So accordingly, processes change, and the change has to be adopted in the operations and had to then get adopted into systems. So, you know, it was like a cycle.
So it's that's how life, it's a job for life.
Yeah. So I really went backward, right? So I started there with testing, and then I came into functional requirements, and I moved into this business process role. And from there to my current role, which is overbearing all of these, right? So I look into a particular compliance unit, which actually caters for all the corporate clients that we hold in the financial institution.
So it's kind of,
it's like a bigger role right now.
Okay. So one, from what, so basically now you've reached this place, right? Like, let's say probably a year or two ago, where you would have kind of stabilized in this. And now you kind of understand that. And then you try to make life easy for, I wouldn't call it, okay, easy or better for both. And primarily making it a little easier for IT, because you're kind of giving it to them. But then, you know, nature is very funny, right? Even after doing all this, okay, IT doesn't move that fast. No, it's got nothing to do with what, like, it's kind of ironic. I think I've talked in many episodes with Deepak also. In fact, like, my last episode was how I messed up. I'm the CTO of the company. It's kind of, I have a funny role. I'm both the tech and the business. Okay, so half of me is business, half of me is tech. Okay. Okay, and I am frustrated with myself now, right? The technology is not moving at the speed the business wants it to move, okay? And so there are things which I can see that IT could do better, but I'm not able to do, okay? So, for example, in my case, it would be like IT, if they say that, you know, you want, let's say, a palace, okay? But you know what? I can't build a palace in 6 months. Okay. I can only do it in, it'll take me 3 years. But you know what? I can give you a one bedroom house in 6 months. Can we figure out a way to live in that?
Yeah.
They won't do that, right? What they will do is at the end of 6 months, they'll come and say, palace is not ready. Then I'll ask them, okay, fine. When will it be ready? Little more time. Okay. How much little more time? Another. It's a 6 month project. So it's another 2 months needed. Okay, take 2 months. Is the palace ready? No, we have now put the the kitchen is ready. Okay, shall we go cooking? No, there's no roof on top. Okay, now we need one more month to do that, right? And then, so it's kind of getting stuck. And the frustration is like, I'm just not able to do anything. At least if you gave me a single bedroom house, I could have started cooking and doing something. Now I don't have a house. I don't have a palace. 1 year is gone. I'm still on the streets. When it rains, I'm getting wet. So this is a frustration I kind of feel, right? So I'm giving an example of, if the IT can, having told all these requirements, if they take a stance and then say, this is what I can do, this is what I can deliver, it makes it easier. Right? So what are your frustrations after having crossed? I mean, it's kind of, I can kind of relate to you because I didn't move from IT to business. The nature is, because I started a company, I am the business.
You became the business.
I became the business by the nature of it, and I needed tech.
And then you have to deal with your old self, right? Later.
And this is even more frustrating. Yeah, correct. And you know what's the even more frustrating? At least for you, you could say that team, right? That side you said no. You can say that team. Now I cannot tell that. My team, my side. It's still, I have to say, it's my team.
Yeah.
Okay, so what are your frustrations after?
No, to having... your point, right? Yeah.
So what are your frustrations?
That and... point that you said, that the one that you said about that one bedroom, right?
Mm.
So I think when I joined, this was 8 years ago, in 2012 is when I came to Singapore. And I think the last, from 2012 to 2016, it was this traditional STLC cycle, as we call it, of, you know, building the whole house in 3 years and giving it to you, right? So somewhere in 2016, sort of there was this paradigm shift where agile came into agile way of working and agile, as they call it, project management, I don't know, whatever it is, that came into play, and where, you know, these small MVPs also came into play. So we said, okay, if we want to do something on a large scale, which is actually going to benefit the entire organization, we do it in small bits and started with small, the least risk area where, you know, even if something goes wrong, we wouldn't have to pay any penalty or we'll not be fined, right? The initial, you're right, the initial cycle of the whole is the system development life cycle was not working. Things changed and people wanted to see that one bedroom as soon as possible and not wait for the entire palace, right? So with that in mind, and we, the organization that I'm also in is very old mind. It's, we are into digital technology and all of it, but change anywhere is, people resist change, right? They do not want change everything overnight. And IT, right? Because they, yeah, go on.
No, your voice broke up. No, I was telling that mindset change is usually the toughest part of this whole thing. I think me and Deepak in all our episodes, somewhere or the other, this mindset would come in, right? Because we are used to doing certain things. There's a comfort zone in doing that. And we are not actually, I guess it's more in East Asian countries, we are not geared for failure. Like failure is attributed to shame. And that kind of little counterintuitive to the agile and the MVP approach. It says fail fast, fail quick. It doesn't say that do quick, succeed quickly. People have that illusion that agile means like do quickly and succeed quickly. No, it's not that. It's actually fail fast, fail quickly, right? But I think that's a little hard here. So I was just probably, I think as you're talking, you can't continue what that shift is. And maybe you can kind of share that part, right? How hard is it to handle?
Very difficult, right? From 2016, this journey of ours started where, you know, these small developments can be done and, you know, changes
by the
can
way,
be
do
made.
You do you do this thing called F-Agile? That's called fake agile.
No, I'm hearing for the first time. What is that?
You don't know fake agile, huh? Sure. How can you be in this?
Oh,
one?
God.
Okay. It's actually not that complicated. Fake agile is this, okay? You have a 2-year project, okay? All you do is you just say, I'm in an agile mode. And what you will do is every 3 months, you will move some code to the testing server or the integration server. And then say we are agile. But the final product will come after 3 years only. So we call that fake agile.
Is this called the technical go live or something?
So it's, so I think
we find different ways to do that.
Yeah, we find different. I think we have seen that, and it kind of frustrates me and Deepak to the core that, you know, we are agile. Okay. How often do you do? Oh, we release every 15 days. Oh, fantastic. How do the end users test it? Oh, no, they don't. Okay. So then how do you say it's released? Oh, we don't push it into the staging server. Yeah. So that's the fake agile I was talking about.
Yeah.
So what was your experience? What was your experience with agile?
So the frustrations, right? The frustrations that we went and we also joined the bandwagon where we also became practitioners of agile. We got ourselves certified. It was pushed to us, right? We can understand.
So you're a scrum master, is it?
Yeah, I'm like a scrum master product owner right now, right?
Okay, got it. Okay.
It was thrust down our throat, right? So it is okay when I'm saying that
curious. Who drives that? I mean, like,
top down.
That's where I'm coming to.
Okay.
Nothing has changed, okay, Kumara? It's still us running the whole thing. But, you know, I really don't know how businesses can sit in. I'm still figuring it out, how businesses can sit in these agile thing, because we have processes that we have to implement immediately, and we have been doing it. It was never that, you know, you wait for whenever there is a change, we do it immediately. We just have a 3 month or a 6 month window to implement it. And so there's nothing like a regulatory requirement that comes in that needs to be done in 10 days. There are, but you know, those become an emergency change. So from a business perspective, I do not know how agile would fit in, and I've always had this question, because we always, whatever we want, we get it done immediately, either through a process, either through a system, if we have to, right? But these long ending projects, when I say long implementation, this future binding projects, like, you know, in the future I need to be sending money but just with a touch of a button and it should land in your pocket, something like that, right? These digitally heavy projects that we have now is now becoming agile. Okay, so the frustrations that I still have is the stand-up calls that we have. Stand-up calls are supposed to be these 5 minutes engagement in the morning, or, you know, 10 of maximum 15 minutes. But you see stand-up calls with 100 people. Oh, closely, I think there was a time when there were 40 people in a stand-up call. Okay.
Okay.
Completely beating the purpose of agile and the stand-up call. That 15-minute meeting became an hour. I'm like, this is definitely not agile, right? No, I mean, I really don't get it.
See, if you see, you know, Deepak is actually taking this call standing up.
I can see that he's standing. Yes.
Okay. So the reason why it was called a stand-up call is because your legs will pain. It's not just like that somebody came out with a stand-up call. Okay.
Yeah.
The reason you have to do a stand-up call is because when you sit, you become comfortable. Okay. And that.
No. You end up sitting, Kumaran. What happened in the end was I used to pull a chair and sit. This was pre-COVID times, okay?
Coffee, tea, biscuit.
I used to sit down. I said, I cannot be standing up like this. I cannot stand. I used to pull a chair and sit down. And then, so then this is how we started.
Mm.
And, but thanks to COVID and stuff, things, I don't know. I mean, I shouldn't say thanks, but, you know, there's been a shift with the way people want to, because I think people want to be looked at as, you know, they are doing something. So I think we are more agile now.
No, you can say thanks. You can say thanks. And I think in the previous episodes, there was a VP from Avanade who had joined, right?
Yeah.
He used to work with us in Microsoft. He said the same thing. He said, like, COVID has really helped us become more agile, and the business, everybody has kind of opened up.
Yes.
So, yeah. Go
so
on.
The last year was fantastic, right? I mean, I've released my maximum, I've had around 8 to 10 implementations this year. So, I mean, it was fantastic. And COVID...
What caused the change? How did that happen? What were the...
One was because of COVID, we had to do emergency changes. So as to factor COVID and the lack of resources in our back offices. So we had to slow down certain things. And that wasn't... So we had to tweak certain of some of our processes to make sure the risks are mitigated. So that was done in a good...
So let me ask that. Let me double click on that. So I think there is a... the devil is in the details, or the solution is in the details, right? Like there's a big organization here, okay? 200,000 employees. And they were trying to switch to Teams, okay? For the past 3 years, okay? They are doing lab testing, alpha testing, beta testing, 50 user, 100 user, nothing is happening, okay? That project has been in cold storage, not cold storage, slow moving pace for 3 years. And they'll say this risk, that risk, and all. Come COVID, 3 months, all 200,000 employees are on Teams, okay? And how did that move? It's just that somebody there took a call on understanding what is a risk and what is not a risk.
Yes.
Right? Instead of just telling, you know, let's just play completely safe. They said for 60 to 70% of the population, we can roll out all features of Teams. It's okay. Okay. Then for another 20%, it's going to be more risky. So we will give them lesser features. The 10% is a highly sensitive place. So for them, we won't give Teams. Now, once somebody took that call, okay, it's a mixture of both business and IT sitting together. So basically, when somebody actually put it down on paper, telling, you know, this is the risk and this is what we are willing to take a risk and fail, that entire project moved forward in 2 weeks. Okay. So like that, something would have happened which gave you this momentum. What were
those? Yes. The triggers were purely risk-based. So like I said, right, I am part of the compliance team where we are governed completely by regulatory risk officers, right, who actually own the whole thing. So these guys got into a room and discussed the possible risk scenarios, and it was very easy, like step 1, 2, 3. And, you know, we had clear, dispensations from the regulators also to go implement it immediately, right? So clearly, like you said, no, we identified what is it that is highest risk. So for example, if I have, if I'm onboarding a sanctions party, right? It is the biggest risk for me as a financial institute.
Okay.
So we tightened it around there, and all other risk factors were given a backseat, and, you know, we got elongated periods of handling those risks if it ever comes. And it was a policy implementation that happened within a week, and that was implemented into the system within a month. So within 20 days is what, 22 days is what it took for us to implement the whole thing. And it was purely because we had, and this was purely agile, right? Because you had the topmost from the bank to tell us that they approve of the risk-based approach. And then it was easy for us to implement. That's the thing, right? These triggers. So if when COVID-like situation is making us do it, right? And we are forced, like you said, even accesses, we never had 100% capacity to go online. Being a bank and being a very highly secured network that we log into, to have the entire bank log into this VPN and for it to support, they have also stepped up at that level to bring it up the curve. And with the right approaches, like you said, right? We just, because the guy sitting on the top gave us the risk-based approach with the dispensation to proceed, we could do it, and everything is followed.
There's nothing like a wasted crisis, you see. And as human beings, I think we are very good at this. Means this is whenever you are faced with a danger, immediate danger, there is nothing which actually explains
it's an inherent quality, right? I mean, it is sleeping for so long.
Exactly.
I mean, I'm seeing agile at its best now. And I'm really proud of what we do, right? Because we always had the opportunity, be it IT, like you said, right? what is it difficult with IT? IT also had to fall in line, right? They had no choice and they couldn't do their usual nakras that, you know, I need 6 months or 1 year, and they had to step up and they had no choice whatsoever, right? I mean, everything, it just worked.
I think that's a very, very good, I would say, summary of the entire crisis in that sense, that
yes,
what made people do certain things. Kumaran, you were saying something.
I was just telling. So the interesting thing is this potential was always there. And I think as Microsoft, right, I think we have faced this challenge with customers. Now, regardless, at least even if I give a leeway to a bank, right? Okay, security and risk there. Any company will repeat the same story. Like, people have to come to office, remote you cannot do, it won't happen. It'll be like some marketing advertising company. And so, you know, digital risk is so much. I think it's basically people didn't want to think about it. I guess, would you kind of say it's about, probably, I'm just relating to what we are talking, as a business itself, defining what failure is, right? So what is a failure? Bad failure, I'm dead, okay? I get a knock on my head, I'm going to lose an arm, I'm going to bleed. So I guess if that is defined clearly, and obviously it's a business who has to do it, and it gets communicated to IT, to the people who are manning the border organizations like you. Now, are you in the border or in the city?
No. Now I've moved to city, right?
Okay.
I don't know.
So it is. So if this moves, I think that might help enterprise IT kind of get a lot more agility, right? It's about. So then it defines what a failure is. Instead of telling no failure, we kind of do some more additional things. And from what you have seen, what would be the top two tips? Like, let's say somebody was working in a border area. Okay, you have one leg gone. I can see you limping, and then your hand, this finger is not there. You are trying to disarm a bomb like that, right? What are the two, three things that you would like to tell somebody working in the border areas? And also for the foot soldier. You can split it up into two. This is for the foot soldier or the architects, whoever is there, and this is for the border security guys. What would that be?
I think for the foot soldiers first, right? They need to adapt to changes, and that too quickly, right? Because the thing is, right, sometimes when I go asking for a solution, when I'm giving my problem, and sometimes I have some ideas which I would share, and then which I would then want the technology to give me better ideas, because I come from that space, so I know certain things, right? But now, since I've come, it's been almost like 5 years now that I moved to the other side, there would have been a lot of development that would have happened, right? I would want them to give me solutions faster, quicker. And I wouldn't say leave the risk and the business to me, but then I would want them to be quick on their toes to give me those better way of implementation. I don't know, somehow they're still stuck to the old way and they do not think out of the box. And sometimes I feel a bit frustrated that, you know, just can't you think out of the box and tell me something that can be done quicker?
So it's basically like whatever you tell, they will convert it word to word to a technology and probably attach a new technology and present it back.
Yeah, they do not brainstorm with ideas. So I'm looking for ideas. I know this is a traditional way to do it, but definitely with the technologies that we have, that brainstorming somehow, you know, they are in this mode of whatever we've been doing well and what
IT has become a factory.
It has become a factory. Am I right to say that? I feel that because I'm from there and I feel sad that, you know, we just stuck there. There was a time when every business guy, right, wanted IT to give a solution, and, you know, it was like a boom. Suddenly it's like, you know, everybody this side knows what exactly is going to come from there. And there is no innovation happening from there. That's one thing that I felt for the foothold. For the borderline people, what I would say is keep it simple, because if you can convey the solution to the business in a simple way with a simple example, and leave the technicalities to the other teams or to the technology teams to it, that would be easy. Because the moment you use terms, and the moment you use those heavy lifted words and sentences, right?
These you switch guys, off both sides. Probably you switch off both sides.
Wow.
Like, I mean, you kind of go and throw a business terminology at the tech guy. That guy gets switched off. You come here and throw a technology here. This guy gets switched off. And there is a seeming tense of, you know, you understand both the worlds. But yeah. In reality, both the worlds don't understand you.
You know, sometimes, Umran, the funniest part is all of them together in a room and me there, right? I'm like, oh, you meaning like this, okay? Which means then I convert. And I really am the interpreter, right? I'm like...
Okay. So that's the flip side of moving from this side to other side. You're kind of forced into that kind of a role.
Yeah.
I think, Kumaran, we need to do an episode on jargon, just jargon.
I would want to learn some new jargons, right? Like, I have a teenager son who uses all these things when we chat, BARB or what those words, right? Those synonyms. And I'm like, what the hell is it? Let me go Google and find out. Suddenly, you know, that makes me feel old. Okay, then I'm like, right now I'm old.
No, that's true, no? It's not a feeling, Suvi. It's reality.
No, I never grow old.
Okay. So I guess, I think a lot of great points. I think the first thing which I typically heard...
You want to bring the mic closer to you?
Yeah. So just to summarize, I guess... things is one, as an IT, right, we need to constantly be agile. And when we mean agile and providing solutions, right, I think as technologists, we think I have to develop a product, and maybe it's not that, right? It's about what are the possibilities. So if I can generate possibilities, right, beyond, it's not just like you told me X and I say how X can be implemented with the IoT or ML solution. Okay, so that's a given. But then it's possibly beyond that, what are the other possibilities is what I think the IT should be giving back. And the second thing which I kind of got is when a requirement is given, I guess it's up to the technology to kind of ask what is the operational aspect of it. How do you operationalize this solution? Who will be the people who are using it? How do they look like? What is their daily life? So rather than just blindly, and it's not that the business doesn't want to give it, it's just that it's a blind spot for them. So probably the technology team has to be more curious about how will people adopt it and use it. So the question is, I'm developing something, but how will it be successful? How will more people use it? I think that would naturally lead us in the directions of asking on how will we operationalize it? What would be the success and failures with that? And last but not the least, stand-up meeting should be finished within 15 minutes.
No, please. Can somebody get that done?
Okay. And I think it's just that, you know, I think this is what I was kind of thinking, like fake agile, right? We said involve the product members. Product owners doesn't mean you pull the product managers also into your project discussion.
Correct. No, I think that's stand-up where... is not a stand-up. Even stand-up is you discuss what you did yesterday. You discuss what you just tell, not discuss. Tell what you did yesterday, what you did today.
There's no discussion.
And then do you have any issues? I mean, three things, right? And then always, and then people would just go on with the story that, you know, that person didn't agree with what I did. And, you know, those conversations, this, literal conversations.
I would say this is Scrum Master's fault. If you catch hold of the Scrum Master, why is this happening?
the biggest one that I had was with 30 people. I forgot who the Scrum Master was. Who was the Scrum Master here, right? It was,
Scrum Master should be held accountable for controlling this stuff.
Yeah, I think that's very critical, important, right? Even if you, And I think there's a reason why they have said 15 minutes, right? Maximum.
Yeah, yeah.
And you kind of stick to that. It helps you get focused. I think these would be the three things which I kind of picked up.
Right. So thank you, Suvi, for making this time on a weekend. And I know we took away time from your weekend tasks and weekend enjoyment, I guess. And it's nearly lunchtime for you. And I hope you have nice lunch after this.
Yes.
So,
yes.
And please, you have a good prepared, join us. I'm being politically correct. I'm just, okay. I did not say she has to make it.
Oh, sorry. Okay, right? We are in the world of
morality. And then, yeah. Said, go eat, enjoy your lunch.
Yes, I did not say she has to make it.
Yeah. But guys, thank you so much for having me. It was fun. And I really, I was a bit afraid, you know, when Kumaran said talk, I'm like, what the hell am I going to talk? And I didn't feel like, I'm saying it was very easy. Thanks to you guys, you've made it very easy for me to talk. Or you people just made it very easy for me to talk. Yeah.
So you're welcome to join us again, and we will pull you in sometimes since we now we know you. And,
I think we should get her probably at least. I think if we get it more than once in 2 months, that value of her would go up. So probably once in 2 months we should get it. And I think it's because like this, Suvi, it's something like. Let's say Deepak is on the technology role player, right? Or he plays that. I am this Ardhanadari, half business, half tech. So it would be actually good if you can take a completely business point of view. So usually we pick up a topic and then probably you can give that perspective.
Sure,
so
definitely. Count me
in. 1 in 2 months we should.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll talk something around IT specific to banking. This time we did very generic areas. We can talk, pick up some areas.
Can talk. Yeah.
Some areas specifically around banking.
Yes.
I think we usually pick up a lot of stuff, but all those things, I think there are, or maybe for example, we can actually say how can truly be agile, right? And the standard things that come up is, you know, we are in banking, we cannot fail, or I used to work with there was too much risk in, you know, healthcare, we cannot take risk. What is it that you are telling? And finally, I had to do a lot of haggle with the COO and the CIO to say, your canteen management, you can try with the new architecture. No, nobody's going to die. So within a hospital, in canteen management, you can take a new technology risk, right? Nobody's going to die with that. Or queue management. Or visitor management. There are so many functional areas within the hospital. Not everything is life dependent on people.
True.
So I think those are the things we could probably discuss. But it's good. I like a lot of nice stories.
Yeah. So thank you, everyone. And
you.
See you next time again.
See you.
Okay.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks, Shubhi.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.